Radio Krishna presents stories about Lord Krishna from the book Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, published by the Bhaktivedanta Book Trust of Los Angeles, California. Derived from the Vedic scripture, the Srimad Bhagavatam, they were written in Sanskrit several thousand years ago by Srila Dwaipayan Vyasadeva and were translated into English by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, founder and spiritual guide of the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. Your narrator is Amala Bhaktadas. And now today's episode, entitled Krishna Lifts Govardhan Hill. My name is Krishna, and I'm the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Lord and Source of all creation. About 5,000 years ago, I lived in Vrindavan, India. Though I looked like and played the part of a human being, I was not at all human, for my body and life were, and always are, composed of absolute knowledge, bliss, and eternality, and are never affected by the material or illusory forces of this world. When I reached the apparent age of 7, one day my brother Balaram and I saw that the cowherd men of Vrindavan were preparing a sacrifice to pacify Indra, the king of heaven, who is responsible for supplying water. However, one who is my devotee has strong and firm faith in the understanding that if he is simply engaged in consciousness of me and in my transcendental loving service, then he is freed from all other obligations. A pure devotee of mine doesn't have to perform any of the ritualistic functions enjoined in the Vedic scriptures, nor is he required to worship demigods. Just by performing the Vedic ritualistic ceremonies or worshiping the demigods, one does not develop devotional service for me. But one who is engaged fully in my service has already finished with all Vedic injunctions. In order to stop all such activities by my devotees, I wanted to firmly establish exclusive devotional service to myself during my presence in Vrindavan. I knew that the cowherd men were preparing for the Indra sacrifice, because I am the omniscient personality of Godhead. But as a matter of etiquette, I began to inquire with great honor and submission from elder personalities like my foster father, Maharaj Nanda. I asked him,
"My dear father, what is this arrangement going on for a great sacrifice? What is the result of such a sacrifice, and for whom is it meant? How is it performed? Will you kindly let me know? I am very anxious to know this procedure, so please explain to me the purpose of this sacrifice."
Upon this inquiry, Nanda Maharaj remained silent, thinking that I would not be able to understand the intricacies of performing the sacrifice. I, however, persisted.
"My dear father, for those who are liberal and saintly, there is no secrecy. They do not think anyone to be a friend or enemy, because they are always open to everyone. And even for those who are not so liberal, nothing should be secret for the family members and friends, although secrecy may be maintained for persons who are hostile. Therefore, you cannot keep any secrets from me. All persons are engaged in fruitive activities. Some know what these activities are, and they know the result. And some execute activities without knowing the purpose or the result. A person who acts with full knowledge gets the full result, and one who acts without knowledge does not get such a perfect result. Therefore, please let me know the purpose of the sacrifice you are going to perform. Is it according to Vedic injunction, or is it simply traditional? Kindly let me know in detail about the sacrifice.
On hearing this inquiry from me, Maharaj Nanda replied,
"My dear boy, this ceremonial performance is more or less traditional. Because rainfall is due to the mercy of King Indra, and the clouds are his representatives, and because water is so important for our living, we must show some gratitude to the controller of this rainfall, King Indra. We are arranging, therefore, to pacify Indra, because he has kindly sent us clouds to pour down sufficient quantity of rain for successful agricultural activities. Water is very important. Without rainfall, we cannot farm or produce grains. We cannot live if there is no rainfall. It is necessary for successful religious ceremonies and economic development and ultimately liberation. Therefore, we should not give up the traditional ceremonial function. If one gives it up, being influenced by lust or greed or fear, then it does not look very good for him."
After hearing this, I, in the presence of my father and all the cowherd men of Vrindavan, spoke in such a way as to make Indra very angry. I suggested that they forego the sacrifice. My reasons for discouraging the sacrifice performed to please Indra were twofold. First, as stated in the Bhagavad Gita, there is no need to worship the demigods for any material advancement. All results derived from worshipping the demigods are simply temporary, and only those who are less intelligent are interested in temporary results. Second, whatever temporary result one derives from worshipping the demigods is actually granted by my permission alone. It is clearly stated in the Bhagavad Gita, "Mayaiva mihitan hitan." Whatever benefit is supposed to be derived from the demigods is actually bestowed by me, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Without my permission, one cannot bestow any benefit upon others. But sometimes the demigods become puffed up by the influence of material nature. Thinking themselves all in all, they forget my supremacy. In this instance, I wanted to make King Indra angry. My advent on earth was especially meant for the annihilation of the demons and protection of the devotees. King Indra was certainly a devotee, not a demon. But because he was puffed up, I wanted to teach him a lesson. I first tried to make Indra angry by stopping the Indra worship that had been arranged by the cowherd men in Vrindavan. With this purpose in mind, I began to talk as if I were an atheist supporting the philosophy of karma mimamsa. Advocates of this type of philosophy do not accept the supreme authority of the Personality of Godhead. They put forward the argument that if anyone works nicely, the result is sure to come. Their opinion is that even if there is a God who gives man the result of his fruitive activities, there is no need to worship him, because unless man works, he cannot bestow any good result. They say that instead of worshiping a demigod or God, people should give attention to their own duties, and thus the good result will surely come. So I began to speak to my father according to these principles of the Karma Mimamsa philosophy.
"My dear father, I don't think you need to worship any demigod for the successful performance of your agricultural activities. Every living being is born according to his past karma and leaves this life simply by taking the result of his present karma. Everyone is born in different types or species of life according to his past activities, and he gets his next birth according to the activities of this life. Different grades of material happiness and distress, comforts and disadvantages of life are different results of different kinds of activities from either the past or the present life.
Maharaj Nanda and other elderly members argued that without satisfying the predominating God, one cannot derive any good result simply by material activities. This is actually the fact. For example, it is sometimes found that in spite of first-class medical help and treatment by a first-class physician, a diseased person dies. It is concluded, therefore, that first-class medical treatment or the attempts of a first-class physician are not in themselves the cause for curing a patient. There must be the hand of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Similarly, a father and mother's taking care of their children is not the cause of the children's comfort. Sometimes it is found that in spite of all care by the parents, the children go bad or succumb to death. Therefore, material causes are not sufficient for results. There must also be my sanction. Nanda Maharaj therefore advocated that in order to get good results for agricultural activities, they must satisfy Indra, the superintending deity of the rain supply. But I nullified this argument, saying that the demigods give results only to persons who have executed their prescribed duties. Therefore, demigods are dependent on the execution of duties and are not absolute in awarding good results to anyone. So I said,
we do not derive any special benefit from Indra. Even if he is there, he pours water on the ocean also, where there is no need of water. So he is pouring water on the ocean or on the land. It does not depend on our worshiping him. As far as we are concerned, we do not need to go to another city or village or foreign country. There are palatial buildings in the cities, but we are satisfied living in this forest of Vrindavan. Our specific relationship is with Govardhan Hill and Vrindavan Forest, and nothing more. I therefore request you, my dear father, to begin a sacrifice which will satisfy the local Brahmins and Govardhan Hill, and let us have nothing to do with Indra.
After hearing my statement, Nanda Maharaj replied,
my dear boy, since you are asking, I shall arrange for a separate sacrifice for the local Brahmins and Govardhan Hill. But for the present, let me execute this sacrifice known as Indra Puja.
But I replied,
my dear father, don't delay. The sacrifice you propose for Govardhan and the local Brahmins will take much time. Better take the arrangement and paraphernalia you have already made for the Indra Yajna and immediately engage it to satisfy Govardhan Hill and the local Brahmins.
Nanda Maharaj finally relented. The cowherd men then inquired from me how I wanted the Yajna performed, and I gave them the following directions.
Prepare very nice foodstuffs of all descriptions from the grains and ghee collected for the yajna. Prepare rice and dal, then halva, pakora, puri, and all kinds of milk preparations like sweet rice and rabri and sweet balls and sandesh and rasgulla, and don't forget the laddu. Lots of laddus, and invite the learned Brahmins who can chant the Vedic hymns and offer oblations to the fire. The Brahmins should be given all kinds of grains and charity. Then, Then you decorate all the cows and feed them very, very well. After performing this, give money in charity to the Brahmins. As far as the lower animals are concerned, such as the dogs, and the lower grades of people, such as the dog-eaters, who are considered untouchable, they also may be given sumptuous foodstuffs. After nice grasses have been given to the cows, the sacrifice known as Govardhan Puja may immediately begin. This sacrifice will very much satisfy me.
I therefore advise the cowherd men to stop the Indra Yajna and begin the Govardhan Puja in order to chastise Indra, who is very much puffed up at being the supreme controller of the heavenly planets. The honest and simple cowherd men, headed by Nanda Maharaj, accepted my proposal and executed in detail everything I advised. According to my instruction, Nanda Maharaj and the cowherd men called in learned Brahmins and began to worship Govardhan Hill by chanting Vedic hymns and offering foodstuffs. The inhabitants of Vrindavan assembled together, decorated their cows, and gave them grass. Keeping the cows in front, they began to walk around Govardhan Hill. The gopis, or milkmaids, also dressed themselves very luxuriantly and sat on bull-driven carts, chanting the glories of my pastimes. Assembled there to act as priests for Govardhan Puja, the Brahmins offered their blessings to the cowherd men and their wives, the gopis. When everything was complete, I assumed a great transcendental form and declared to the inhabitants of Vrindavan that I myself was Govardhan Hill in order to convince the devotees that Govardhan Hill and I are identical. Then I began to eat all the food offered there. The identity of me and Govardhan Hill is still honored, and great devotees take rocks from Govardhan Hill and worship them exactly as they worship the statue deity of me in the temples. Devotees therefore collect small rocks or pebbles from Govardhan Hill and worship them at home, because this worship is as good as deity worship. This huge form of me, which began to eat the offerings, was separately constituted, and I myself, along with the other inhabitants of Vrindavan, began to offer obeisances to the deity, as well as to Govardhan Hill. In offering obeisances to the huge form of myself and Govardhan Hill, I declared,
"Just see how Govardhan Hill has assumed this huge form and is favoring us by accepting all of the offerings. One who neglects the worship of Govardhan Puja, as I am personally conducting it, will not be happy. There are many snakes on Govardhan Hill, and persons neglecting the prescribed duty of Govardhan Puja will be bitten by these snakes and killed. In order to assure the good fortune of the cows and themselves, all people of Vrindavan near Govardhan must worship the hill as prescribed by me."
Thus performing the Govardhan Puja sacrifice, all the inhabitants of Vrindavan followed my instructions, and afterwards they returned to their respective homes. When Indra understood that I had stopped the sacrifice that was about to be offered by the cowherd men in Vrindavan, he became angry. He vented his anger upon the inhabitants of Vrindavan, although Indra knew perfectly well that I was personally protecting them. As the director of the different kinds of clouds, Indra called for the Samvartak. This cloud is invited when there is need to devastate the whole cosmic manifestation. The Samvartak was ordered by Indra to go over Vrindavan and flood the whole area extensively. Demoniacally, Indra thought himself to be the all-powerful Supreme Personality. When demons become very powerful, they defy me, the Supreme Controller. Indra, though not a demon, was puffed up by his material position, and he wanted to challenge my controllership. He thought himself, at least for the time being, as powerful as I. So Indra said,
"Just see the impudence of the inhabitants of Vrindavan. They are simply inhabitants of the forest, but being infatuated with their little friend Krishna, who is nothing but an ordinary human being, they have dared defy the demigods."
I have declared in the Bhagavad Gita that the worshippers of the demigods are not very intelligent. I have also declared that one has to give up all kinds of worship and simply concentrate his consciousness on me. My invoking the anger of Indra and later on chastising him is a clear indication to my devotees that those who are engaged in consciousness of me have no need to worship any demigod, even if it is found that the demigod has become angry. For I, Krishna, give my devotees all protection, and they should completely depend on my mercy. Indra cursed the action of the inhabitants of Vrindavan and said,
"By defying the authority of the demigods, the inhabitants of Vrindavan will suffer in material existence. Having neglected the sacrifice to the demigods, they cannot cross over the impediments of the ocean of material misery. These cowherd men in Vrindavan have neglected my authority on the advice of this talkative boy who is known as Krishna. He is nothing but a child, and by believing a child, they have enraged me."
Thus he ordered the Samvartak cloud to go and destroy the prosperity of Vrindavan.
"The men of Vrindavan have become puffed up over their material opulence and their confidence in the presence of their tiny friend, Krishna. He is simply talkative, childish, and unaware of the complete cosmic situation, although he is thinking himself, very advanced in knowledge. Because they have taken Krishna so seriously, they must be punished. And so I have ordered the Samvartak cloud to go there and inundate the place. They should be destroyed with their cows."
Ordered by King Indra, all the dangerous clouds appeared above Vrindavan and began to pour water incessantly with all their strength and power. There was constant lightning and thunder, blowing of severe wind, and incessant falling of rain. The rainfall seemed to fall like piercing sharp arrows. By pouring water as thick as pillars, without cessation, the clouds gradually filled all the lands in Vrindavan with water, and there was no visible distinction between higher and lower land. The situation was very dangerous, especially for the animals. The rainfall was accompanied by great winds, and every living creature in Vrindavan began to tremble from the severe cold. Unable to find any other source of deliverance, they all approached me to take shelter at my feet. the cows especially, being much aggrieved from the heavy rain, bow down their heads, and taking their calves underneath their bodies, they approached me. At that time, all the inhabitants of Vrindavan began to pray to me.
Oh, dear Krishna, you are all-powerful, and you are very affectionate to your devotees. Now, please protect us, who have been much harassed by angry Indra.
Upon hearing their prayer, I could also understand that Indra, being bereft of his sacrificial honor, was pouring down rain that was accompanied by heavy pieces of ice and strong winds, although all this was out of season. I understood that this was a deliberate exhibition of anger by Indra. I therefore concluded,
"This demigod, who thinks himself supreme, has shown his great power. But I shall answer him according to my position, and I shall teach him that he is not autonomous in managing universal affairs. I am the supreme lord over all, and I shall thus take away his false prestige, which has arisen from his power. The demigods are my devotees, and therefore it is not possible for them to forget my supremacy. But somehow or other, he has become puffed up with material power, and thus is now maddened. I shall act in such a way as to relieve him of this false prestige. I shall give protection to my pure devotees in Vrindavan, who are at present completely at my mercy, and whom I have taken completely under my protection. I will save them by my mystic power."
Thinking in this way, I immediately picked up Govardhan Hill with my left hand, exactly as a child picks up a mushroom from the ground. Thus I exhibited my transcendental pastime of lifting Govardhan Hill. I then began to address my devotees.
"My dear brothers, my dear father, my dear inhabitants of Vrindavan, you can now safely enter under the umbrella of Govardhan Hill, which I have just lifted. Do not be afraid of the hill and think that it will fall from my hand. No, it won't. You have been too much afflicted from the heavy rain and strong wind. Therefore, I have lifted this hill, which will protect you exactly like a huge umbrella. I think this is a proper arrangement to relieve you of your immediate distress. So be happy now, along with your animals, under this great umbrella."
Being assured by me, all the inhabitants of Vrindavan entered beneath the great hill and appeared to be safe, along with their property and animals. The inhabitants of Vrindavan and their animals remained there for 1 week without being disturbed by hunger, thirst, or any other discomforts. They were simply astonished to see how I was holding up the mountain with the little finger of my left hand. Seeing my extraordinary mystic power, Indra, the king of heaven, was thunderstruck and baffled in his determination. He immediately called for all the clouds and asked them to desist. When the sky became completely cleared of all clouds and there was sunrise again, the strong wind stopped. At that time, I said,
"My dear cowherd men, you can now leave and take your wives and children and cows and valuables, because everything is ended. The flood has gone down along with the swelling waters of the river."
All the men loaded their valuables on carts and slowly left with their cows and other paraphernalia. After they had cleared out everything, I slowly replaced Govardhan Hill exactly in the same position as it had been before. a Sarabi or wish-fulfilling cow from the spiritual world, Goloka Vrindavan, as well as King Indra from the heavenly planet, then appeared before me. Indra was conscious of his offense. Therefore, he stealthily appeared before me from a secluded place. He immediately fell down at my feet, his crown dazzling like sunshine. Indra knew about my exalted position because I am the master of Indra, but he could not believe that I could come down and live in Vrindavan among the cowherd men. When I defied Indra's authority, he became angry because he thought that he was all in all within this universe and that no one was as powerful as he. But after this incident, his false, puffed-up prestige was destroyed. Being conscious of his subordinate position, he appeared before me with folded hands and began to offer the following prayers.
My dear Lord, being puffed up by my false prestige, I thought that you had offended me by not allowing the cowherd men to perform the Indra sacrifice, and I thought that you wanted to enjoy the offerings that were arranged for me. I thought that in the name of a Govardhan sacrifice, you were taking my share of profit, and I therefore mistook your position. Now, by your grace, I can understand that you are the Supreme Lord, personality of Godhead, and that you are transcendental to all material qualities. Your transcendental position is pure goodness, which is above the platform of ordinary goodness, and your transcendental abode is beyond the disturbance of the material qualities. Your name, fame, form, qualities, and pastimes are all beyond this material nature, and they are never disturbed by the three material modes, goodness, passion, and ignorance. Your abode is accessible only for one who undergoes severe austerities and penances, and who is completely freed from the onslaught of material qualities like passion and ignorance. If someone thinks that when you come within this material world, you accept the modes of material nature, he is mistaken. The webs of material qualities are never able to touch you, and you certainly do not accept them when you are present within this world. Your lordship is never conditioned by the laws of material nature. Lord, please accept my prostrated obeisances. You are the personification of supreme knowledge. You can appear anywhere according to your desire in any one of your eternal forms. You are the root of all creation and the supreme soul of all living entities. Due to my gross ignorance, I created a great disturbance in Vrindavan by sending torrents of rain and a heavy hailstorm. I acted out of severe anger caused by your stopping the sacrifice, which was to be held to satisfy me. But, my dear Lord, you are so kind to me that you have bestowed your mercy upon me by destroying all my false pride. I therefore take shelter unto your lotus feet.
Thus praised by Indra, I smilingly said,
My dear Indra, I have stopped your sacrifice just to show my causeless mercy and to revive your memory that I am your eternal master. I am not only your master, but the master of all the other demigods as well. You should always remember that all your material opulences are due to my mercy. Everyone should always remember that I am the Supreme Lord. I can show anyone my favor, and I can chastise anyone, because no one is superior to me. If I find someone overpowered by false pride, in order to show him my causeless mercy, I withdraw all his opulences.
After instructing Indra, I asked him to return to his kingdom in the heavenly planet, and to remember always that he is never the supreme, but is always subordinate to me. I also advised him to remain as King of Heaven, but to be careful of false pride. After this, the transcendental Sarabi cow, who also came with Indra to see me, offered her respectful obeisances to me and worshipped me. The Sarabi offered her prayers as follows.
My dear Lord Krishna, you are the most powerful of all mystic yogis because you are the soul of the complete universe, and only from you has all this cosmic manifestation taken place. Therefore, although Indra tried his best to kill my descendant cows in Vrindavan, they remained under your shelter, and you have protected them all so well. We do not know anyone else as the Supreme, nor do we go to any other god or demigods for protection. Therefore, you are our Indra. You are the Supreme Father of the whole cosmic manifestation. And you are the protector and elevator of all the cows, Brahmins, demigods, and others who are pure devotees of your lordship. O super soul of the universe, let us bathe you with our milk, because you are our Indra. O Lord, you appear just to diminish the burden of impure activities on the earth. In this way, I was bathed by the milk of the Sarabi cow, and Indra bathed me with the water of the celestial Ganges through the trunk of his carrier elephant. After this, the King of Heaven, Indra, along with Sarabi cows, all other demigods, and their mothers, worshipped me by bathing me with Ganges water and the milk of the Sarabis. Thus I was pleased with all of them. The residents of all higher planetary systems, such as Gandharvaloka, Vidyadharaloka, Siddhaloka, and Charanaloka, all combined and began to glorify me by chanting my holy name. Their wives and damsels began to dance with great joy. They very much satisfied me by incessantly pouring flowers from the sky. When everything was very nicely and joyfully settled, the cows overflooded the surface of the earth with their milk. The water of the rivers began to flow and give nourishment to the trees, producing fruits and flowers of different colors and tastes. The trees began to pour drops of honey. The hills and mountains began to produce potent medicinal plants and valuable stones. Because of my presence, all these things happened very nicely, and the lower animals, who were generally envious, were envious no longer. After satisfying me, King Indra took his permission to return to his heavenly kingdom. He was surrounded by all kinds of demigods who passed with him through cosmic space. This great incident is a powerful example of how consciousness of me can benefit the entire world. Even the lower animals forget their envious nature and become elevated to the qualities of the demigods. This story was entitled Krishna Lifts Govardhan Hill.
and was presented by Radio Krishna and produced by Krishna Productions at the KHQN Studios in Los Angeles, California. It was derived from the book Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, written by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, founder and spiritual guide of the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, and published by the Bhaktivedanta Book Trust in Los Angeles, California. The musical selections and engineering were under the direction of Vaibhavi Devidasi, and the story adaptation for radio and voice characterizations were done by your narrator, Amala Bhaktadas.